2 Timothy chapter number 1. I'm going to read a few verses and then we'll have a word of prayer. In fact, let's give attendance to read. I'm going to read the entire first chapter. Let's do that. It's good to do that. 2 Timothy chapter number 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, according to the promise of life which is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dearly beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I've served from my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. Wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Amen. Amen. Hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. That good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost, which dwelleth in us. This thou knowest, that all they which are in Asia be turned away from me, of whom are Phygellus and Hermogenes. The Lord give mercy unto the house of Onesiphorus, for he oft refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chain. But when he was in Rome, he sought me out very diligently and found me. The Lord grant unto him that he may find mercy of the Lord in that day. And in how many things he ministered unto me at Ephesus, thou knowest very well. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we do stop right now. We humble our hearts and minds, Father, giving you thanks and praise for the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for his blessed blood given on Calvary's cross as a sacrifice for our sins. We thank you for his glorious resurrection, the proof of life, as it were, Father, to show that we too can have that everlasting life. We can have that resurrection life as a free gift by God's grace. We thank you for the Holy Scriptures, Father, that we're going to study today. And the purpose of studying this, Father, is to understand your will, your mind, through your word. And so we thank you for these scriptures. We ask as we study them today, with those of like precious faith corporately here at Norcalgrace, that you give us all insight and wisdom and understanding of your word. And as always, a greater appreciation of your son, the Lord Jesus Christ. It's in his wonderful name we pray. Amen. All right. 2 Timothy. This is one of my favorite books. It's probably second only to the book of Philippians. It is Paul's last will and testament. He's now Paul the aged. If you look at Acts 9, you don't have to go there. But when you read Acts 9, it says he was a young man named Saul. But this is 30 plus years after his salvation, after the ministry. This is his last will and testament. He's in prison under Rome and Nero. Nero was the Roman Caesar or emperor at that time. And Paul's going to die. Okay. But before he dies, he says, Timothy, preach the word, protect the word. 1 Timothy is protect the word. 2 Timothy is preach the word. And I wrote a few notes here. This is how when I study, I just make notes. So I don't use a study Bible. I don't trust them. They don't rightly divide. So I just make my own notes. So I wrote these over the years. I'm just going to look at it. It says the last days. The focus of 2 Timothy is the last days of the dispensation of grace. It's the actual last book. So it's a prophecy kind of looking towards what the last day is going to be like. OK, and what it's going to be like is how they are today. We're going to see that. In the last days, God wants us to hear his words. It's going to be a scarce. It's going to be a famine, even among his own people. I was listening to the radio yesterday, driving. We were coming from the store or something. And I made the mistake of turning on Christian radio. And there was a guy on there, a preacher, if you want to call him that. And he was in Matthew chapter 6, where it says, if you don't forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you. And he was telling his audience, the people, I don't really understand that, because, you know, I know we're under grace, but that's what that verse says. And so he was all confused. He confused everybody. He didn't rightly divide the word. And that's what Paul is going to say. It's in 2 Timothy where we learn to rightly divide the word of truth. 2 Timothy 2:15, because it's going to be a scarcity of even the people who profess Christ, members of the body. They won't know the word. So Timothy is to preserve the rightly divided word and then preach it. Okay. 2 Timothy 4. There's Richard and Rachel. There you go. We're going to need one more. Or they can sit back there. Okay. Timothy's a pastor. And so one of the reasons this is my second favorite book is because as a pastor, it reads right to my heart. When I read these words, in fact, I see myself as Timothy. Timothy's personality was kind of more softer and timid. It wasn't strong like Titus. Titus was a fiery type of dude. Timothy was more gentle. The word Timothy, remember what we saw, Timothy. It's also Timotheus, okay? And it means Timo, Theos means God. Timo means to honor. And the name that his mother gave him, and we'll see that. Good morning, Richard. Good morning. Timothy means to honor God, or one who honors God. And so even though that's his name and his name personally, this can apply to each and every one of us. If you want to honor God, this book, the Bible rightly divided, will do that. OK, couple other things. He's a pastor. I see myself when I read these passages, I see the same heart that Timothy had. Paul's going to talk about mindful of thy tears. He was a sensitive soul. And I know I am that way. He cared deeply for people and for the apostle. He felt his whole life was made as from a little boy to minister to others. I can feel that in that same spirit. It's a picture of the body of Christ in the last days. There's going to be the apostates, those who don't listen to the apostle Paul, and then the faithful, those who do. And so what I want us to see today is, how does Paul minister in his last days? He knows he's about to die, chapter 4, okay? So this is his last will and testament. Let's look at it. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 1. Like every other book that Paul writes, he starts it off with his name. Look at that, Paul. You know, I went to a local coffee shop this morning and to get Krista and I a coffee to start off our weekend. And you know, they kind of talked to you, say, hey, what's going on, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, you know, getting a cup of coffee. We're going to go have church services and stuff. He's like, oh, really? Where? I said, well, Norcalgrace and Carmichael. I said, I'm Pastor Ron Knight. You know, he said, oh, that's great. He's like, what you going to teach on today? I said, 2 Timothy chapter 1. He says, oh, wow, remind me what that's about. As if he knew. He was like a young man in his 20s. I said, well, that's Paul's last will and testament. I go, do you know who Paul is? He said, oh, yeah. He goes, he wrote a lot of the Bible, didn't he? I said, yes. I said, he wrote most of the books of the, he wrote more books of the Bible than any man. I said, and I explained the importance of that. He's like, oh, okay, Ron Knight, Norcalgrace. I said, yeah, check us out. I said, we got YouTube videos. But anyway, I was explaining to him, Paul, 13 times Paul writes his name on these epistles. How you doing, Rachel? And he does that to magnify his office. Paul wrote more books of the Bible than any man. Moses wrote 5. John the Apostle wrote 5. Paul wrote 13, more than both of them combined. And what God is doing is magnifying Paul's office, Romans 11:13, right? I magnify my office. And so every book of the Bible that starts with this man named Paul, that's your doctrine. He's our apostle. Let's look at it. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ. It is the Lord himself who commissioned Paul in Acts 9 on the road to Damascus. He says, by the will of God, God the Father chose Paul. And he says, according to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus. That issue of according, in line with what God has promised. God has promised that anyone who trusts Christ Jesus, by the way, I want you to see. He says an apostle of Jesus Christ. Look at the first part of that verse. When he calls him Jesus Christ like that, that has to do with his who he is, his person. He's Jesus, which is the Christ, right? He is a real man who lived in Israel nearly 2,000 years ago. He's the Son of God, Jesus Christ. But when Paul uses this term, Christ Jesus, this one is not just focused on his person, because he was a real person. This one, his suffering, that's right. He suffered on that cross. The sufferings of Christ and the glory that shall be revealed. So when you see him call him Christ or Christ Jesus, he's talking about the suffering one. Yes, he is the Lord Jesus. Well, the Lord is, by the way, when he puts the Lord or Lord Jesus Christ, this has to do with the righteous judge. We're going to see later in 2 Timothy chapter number 4. So Paul has all of these different titles for Jesus. By the way, I mentioned that guy on that so-called Christian station. He was in Matthew. All he kept saying is Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And in my mind, I'm saying, when is this guy going to call him the Lord Jesus Christ? Give him his due. He's the Lord Jesus Christ. You hear him out. When they're all in Matthew, all these denominations, they real familiar with him, you know, kind of just Jesus. But he's more than just Jesus. When you focus on his earthly ministry in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four Gospels, that's where you get. You just see him as Jesus of Nazareth. But he's more than Jesus of Nazareth. He is the Lord Jesus Christ. And when Paul calls him Lord, he's focused the righteous judge. Jesus Christ, his person. Christ Jesus, his suffering, this one who suffered. And what he has accomplished through the cross, this suffering has to do with what he did at Calvary. Okay, look at this verse. Verse number one. Paul, an apostle. By the way, apostle means a sent one. God sent this man to you and I today. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God. This was the overall will of God. According to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus. So if you go into the one who suffered, if you go to that one, God will give you everlasting life. Go over one book, go over to Titus. It's probably just a couple of pages in your Bible. Go over to Titus chapter 1. Go forward to Titus chapter 1. Let me talk to you about this life. Look at verse 2. Titus 1 verse 2. In hope, Titus 1 verse 2. In hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie. By the way, it says that God who cannot lie, God cannot lie. Angels can lie if they choose to. Obviously, all men lie at some point in their life. And he didn't just say can't. He didn't just say cannot. When he puts those together like that, that's an impossibility. Cannot lie. He's God. Because anything God says, it's going to come to pass because he is truth. So if he says something, now it's going to sound weird. Even if he didn't want to come to pass, it's going to come to pass because he's God. He is the truth. And he cannot lie. You can trust him. Watch this. What didn't he lie about? Verse 2, in hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie, promised, remember that promise of life? But notice when he promised it, before the world began. This was before he created anything, before the earth, before Adam, before man, before the angels were created. God had a plan of glory in his son, Jesus, through the cross, and he included people like you and me today. Look at verse number 3. But hath in due times, different times on his appointment schedule, manifested his word through preaching. And Paul defines preaching for Colossians 1 as what? Warning and teaching. There's a warning for every man. The fact Jesus had to die. We're going to look at that. Let me just put Romans chapter 1 on there. But I'm not ashamed. The fact he had to die is a warning to man. If the Son of God had to come down from heaven's glory and die on that cruel and criminal cross, if he had to die, then he died your death. You need to trust him because he had to suffer and die. That's what every man has to endure. Now, God doesn't want you to endure. That's why he sent his son. But that's a warning. And then another thing that a preacher does, he warns and he teaches. And Paul's going to teach us. Look what he says. Verse number 3, Titus 1, 3. But hath in due times manifested his word through preaching, but not just any preaching, which is committed unto who? Me, that's Paul. Paul talks about the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, Romans 16:25, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest. The preaching for today comes through Paul's epistles. That's why we have to rightly divide the word of truth. Notice what it says in verse 3, which is committed unto me according to the commandment of God our Savior. So God has sent Paul to preach this life in the suffering one, Christ Jesus, okay? The only way you can get his life is he has to give it to you. And he's willing to give it to all of us by faith. That's why we have to trust him. That's what the gospel of grace is. All right, go back. Now, if you don't trust him, if you choose not to trust him, you can go and suffer the wrath of God on your own. He's perfectly fine with that. He's just saying, I have compassion on you. We're going to see this word mercy. And God is a merciful God, which means, you know what, a good definition of mercy, just right on its surface level, we hear people say mercy is not getting what you deserve. And that's true. But it's more than that. It's someone who has compassion for you, and then they take action. Let me show you the difference. We'll see something. They take action. And God gave a gospel, a good news or glad tidings. Okay, I'm just going to write this down so I can remember. Now watch this. For example, you could pity someone and have compassion. You could see someone struggling on the streets and starving and say, my heart goes out, I feel for you. And you really do feel for them, right? You do. You could. And you could just keep going, go to McDonald's, eat your sandwich, and look at them outside the window. I'm sorry, man. Brother got problems of his own. That's compassion. Mercy is you take the action and then maybe give them some food or whatever. You know, I give them a track and some food, buy them food, but give them a track. They need to have spiritual food, too. They got to get saved. And the Lord said that. He says, who showeth mercy? That whole Good Samaritan, you know, people talk about Good Samaritan. A lot of hospitals are named Good Samaritan. Two major names for hospitals are this. Watch this. Mercy Hospital. There's a Mercy Hospital everywhere. Chicago, Minneapolis. Jada-Lynn was born at Mercy Hospital in Coon Rapids, Minnesota. And then, so there's a Mercy Hospital and Good Samaritan. There are a lot of hospitals named, interesting, Good Samaritan and Mercy. Wonder why? Because from that parable from the Lord Jesus, it's that Good Samaritan parable where he not only saw the guy half dead, but he helped him, you know, took care of him, bound up his wounds, put him in a nice hospital, basically, paid for it. He says, who is the one who showeth mercy? Who had compassion but took action? Listen, these men were walking by, saw the guy. A couple of them saw him. A couple of Levites and priests, the religious system didn't do nothing for them, looked on them, and one of them said, went across the street. He just left them. That's religion for you. Religion ain't going to help you. Religion can't help you in your messed up situation. That's the lie of Satan. The Good Samaritan, and that who's the Lord was, the Good Samaritan, the one who the Jews hated, the Samaritan, he helped that Jew. And he said, which of this showeth mercy? The one who helped the man. And so mercy is compassion, but God's going to take some action. We'll see that in a moment, okay? All right, let's keep going. I brought that up because look at the next verse. Oh, by the way, back to that so-called preacher. He didn't rightly divide, so he confused people. He had people thinking that in order for God to forgive them, they must forgive others. Now, although God wants you to forgive others, your salvation today under grace is not based on whether you forgive others. Paul says, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. God forgives you whether you forgive others or not. He wants you to forgive because unforgiveness hurts you, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. If you hold on to that stuff, you're not hurting the other person, you're hurting yourself. Mm-hmm. You are. You're hurting yourself. Look at verse 2. 2 Timothy 1, verse 2. To Timothy. Love that. His name means to one who honors God. So even though this was a real man, a real person, this is true for all of us. Look at what he said. My dearly beloved son. Now, he wasn't his physical son, his biological son. Timothy's biological father was an uncircumcised Greek Gentile, not Paul. But he called him son because as a son with the father, he labored with me in the gospel. And so he was like a father figure to Timothy. They labored together. That's why he calls him my son. Verse number two, grace, that's the free gift of God's salvation. but also what? Mercy and peace. Now, Paul normally starts his epistles, grace and peace. But with Timothy, particularly, he puts this issue of mercy in there. Okay, let me explain why. Let's look at a couple other times he did that. By the way, not just with Timothy, the pastoral epistle. Go back to 1 Timothy 1. Go back to 1 Timothy chapter 1. So Paul, he changes up his usual salutation. Most of the time he says grace and peace. But with Timothy and Titus, notice this. Look at 1 Timothy chapter number 1, verse 2. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 2. Unto Timothy, my own son in the faith. That's how you know when he says my beloved son, it's in the faith. Grace, look at that. Mercy and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. Go back to that book of Titus. Go forward to Titus again. Look what he says to Titus. And what I'm going to show you, this mercy is connected with ministry, okay? It's connected with ministry. The ministry of grace. Let me tell you, as a minister of God's grace for almost 20 years now, you need the mercy of God. You know why? Because we're human, just like everybody else. Mm-hmm. Men put men on pedestals. Mm-hmm. Don't do that. Mm-hmm. The religious system and the denominational system put their preachers, pastors, bishops, popes, priests, all these people on pedestals. Don't do that. Don't want to get you in trouble, but they're men too. Mm-hmm. And forget these religious guys, but in the body of Christ, these men's part is to teach and preach the truth. Not all of them do it. That's why we don't have enough grace churches. It's not God's fault. It's men. It's men who part in the body like mine to teach the saints who don't want to suffer for this truth and not faithful to it. It's not God's fault. It's man's fault. People need to hold their preachers accountable. This goof on the radio can't explain why in one passage it says, if you don't forgive men their trespasses, neither will God. But he doesn't understand why Paul's epistles say the exact opposite. God forgives you without forgiveness. And he was like, I don't know what to do with it. I know. Get out the pulpit then. It's called rightly dividing the word of truth. By the way, he said this. He says one of his congregants came up after he said that. He goes, we're saved by grace here. We don't need to forgive others for God to forgive us. He goes, I don't understand it, but that's what the verse said. Well, it was in another dispensation. Israel was under the law. You had to do things in order to get God to move. We're under grace. All the guy had to do was rightly divide. He could have. Anyway. It's just, pastors, man. These guys don't work. Mercy, minister of grace. Watch this. Look what he says in Titus. Titus chapter 1, verse number 4. Look at Titus 1, verse 4. Titus was a minister as well. By the way, he had the opposite personality of Timothy. Titus was strong and aggressive. Anytime Paul needed something done, he sent Titus. And I'm talking about when he needed to deal with some people. Timothy was more timid, easygoing, kind of. Titus was like, get in your face and you know, drop the hammer. Sometimes you need both of that, don't you? Mm-hmm. You need the one who can kind of, my specialty is kind of graciously dealing with people, you know, long-suffering and stuff. But sometimes, you know, sometimes you got to be fired. It's like that balance. Look at here. Titus was fired. Look at verse 4. To Titus, my own son, after the common faith. It's the grace of God, the faith of Christ. Notice he says to Titus, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, Lord Jesus Christ. By the way, you know, I was thinking about why Titus is at Crete. Let me show you about you ever heard somebody's called a Cretan? A Cretan? And that's not a good thing. If somebody called you a Cretan, that's a bad thing. It comes from this passage. Look at verse number 5. For this cause left I thee. So Paul left Titus in Crete. That's the island of Crete in the Mediterranean there. That thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting. He says, I need a man to go get things right over there. You're the man. And ordain elders in every city as I'd appointed thee. So he's going to go through the type of men. But go down to verse number 10, Titus 1:10. This was a job that Timothy couldn't do. You see the title here? Timothy was, his personality was too soft. He would have been in tears. Titus, you ain't making Titus cry. He'll bust your side. Titus, don't be hitting people, man. Don't hit them. Don't be a brawler. Paul tells Titus in here, be no brawlers. Because he would be like, boy, you better get it. Listen, let me tell you about Titus. when the Lord Jesus Christ sent Paul to Jerusalem, Acts 15, Galatians 2, we've seen in our study, the Gentile that he picked, Paul had his pick of all these uncircumcised Greek Gentiles who got saved. Guess who he took with him to Jerusalem? Titus. He took him right into the belly of the beast, man, with all these Jewish apostles, Peter, James, John, all of them. Because Titus wasn't afraid of nobody. Titus said, yep, I'm uncircumcised. I'm a Gentile. I'm saved. And they didn't say nothing. Timothy was all he was half Jewish anyway. So, you know, he was half Israeli. So it wasn't a big deal. He just needed to get circumcised. We'll talk about that. But the point is, Titus was strong. And here's why. Look at these Cretans. Look at verse 10. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision. So these Jewish guys of Crete, they were opposing Paul's message. Look at verse 11. Whose mouths must be stopped. Dang. It's a lot of that today too. They just need to be quiet. Who subvert whole houses. They just mess up households because of what they're teaching. Teaching things which they ought not. And here's the reason. For filthy lucre, it's lucrative. Religion, lying to people is lucrative, whether you're a politician or a preacher. It's lucrative. It's filthy lucre, though. Ill-gotten gain. The love of money is the root of all evil, Paul says in 1 Timothy. And so they don't mind lying to you, not explaining the Bible so you can understand it, so that you can give them money. Filthy lucre. Well, watch what he says. Look at verse 12. One of themselves, a Cretan, even a prophet of their own said, now he's going to quote, there's a guy named Epimendes, you can look him up. He lived between 500 and 600 BC. Epimendes, he was a Cretan prophet or poet. He was a poet. He was like, you know how the Greeks have philosophers like Socrates and Plato? This guy was one of them. You can look him up outside of the Bible, secular history. And he wrote a line like this. He said, the Cretans are always what? Always liars in every way they lie. When they mouth, how do you know if a Cretan's lying? Their mouth is moving. And when it ain't, they thinking a lie in their mind. They crafting it. I'm lying to you. Evil beast. They ready to devour people. Slow bellies. This is all politicians too. Yes, everything about this slow belly. All they do is craft things that can, belly is your carnal desires. Look at verse 13. Paul says, you know that heathen who wrote that? Even though I'm a God's apostle, that witness is true. God uses outside sources like prophets poets of these heathen. And Paul will say, y'all know how y'all know all that famous stuff? That's true, what he just said. Look at here. Verse 13. This witness is true. Wherefore rebuke them sharply. Timothy couldn't do sharp rebuke. Titus could. And sometimes with these preachers, you got to give them, sharp rebuke. Why would he do that? That they may be sound in what? The faith. You know the worst part about all this? He's not talking about lost people at Crete. He's talking about saved people. He's talking about brothers in the Lord who are preachers. Sad. It's sad. By the way, one of my studies I'm going to post on tomorrow, it'll be about preachers. And what's the preacher's job in these last days when it comes to politics and all this stuff? See, Paul is saying that they're liars, evil beasts, and slow bellies. And he wasn't talking about the lost. He was talking about saved brethren in the body, preachers. Because he says that they might be sound in the faith. They're in Christ. That's a sad state of affairs. But the guy you wanted going there was Titus. He was ready to kick butt and take names, as they say. He was the guy. And the body of Christ needs that. You need that. You need, like Timothy, kind of a softer kind of deal with people with long suffering and doctrine. Go back to Timothy. So this issue of mercy, Paul adds that to grace and peace, because if you're in ministry, you need the mercy of God, but also it's tied to the ministry of God's grace. Go back to 1 Timothy chapter 1. Let me show you this. God wants us to minister the same message he gave the Apostle Paul. Look at 1 Timothy chapter number 1. 1 Timothy chapter number 1. And look at verse number 11. Let's start at verse 11. 1 Timothy 1:11. Speaking of his doctrine. Verse 11. According to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust. Paul's going to talk about the gospel of grace here. Here we go. And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, when he calls him Christ Jesus, what's the focus? His suffering and the glory. When he calls him our Lord, the one who's going to judge us all righteously. He's the righteous judge. When you talk about ministry, you're talking about the righteous judge. Keep going. Verse 12, and I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who hath enabled me. He's powered by the Lord. For that he counted me what? Faithful, putting me into ministry. Now, if you think about Saul of Tarsus in Acts 9, Acts 8, Acts 7, what's faithful about this man who was out there killing Jewish believers in Jesus Christ, the Messianic Kingdom Church? Well, he was faithful to do that job, kill people. He was these Islamic extremists. These guys goes to great length to cause harm. That was Paul. They're zealous about their religion. And God looked at that and said, you know, I can use that zeal, man. I want that man because look at his zeal. Now, his zeal is he's trying to persecute me. Saul, why persecute thou me, the Lord said. But when Paul says he counted me faithful, he goes, that's the man for the job. I just got to give him the truth. Amen. And nothing stopped Paul, whether it was good or bad. I'm going to show you that. His conscience was clear his whole life. He just, I'm going to do it. Here we go. He counted me faithful, putting me in the ministry. And he said, let me show you the type of man I was, who was before a blasphemer. He literally insulted Almighty God in the Lord Jesus. And a persecutor. He had those Jewish believers in Jesus as their Messiah, that kingdom, those kingdom saints. He persecuted. He followed. Persecute means to run after them. They could go all the way to Damascus. He went all the way to get them and pull them back to the religious jails of Jerusalem. This man was a zealot. Why you think ISIS, they said, we're going to get into every nation. They're going to go right into the Syrian population, and they're going to come right on in. They so bold, they just tell you, we're going to infiltrate the refugee population, then we're going to blow some stuff up. They're telling us that. Mm-hmm. They're telling us that. Because they're zealous about their thing. They want to go where the infidel is, and we want to get them there. Mm-hmm. Look what he says. I was a blasphemer, verse 13. 13 is the number of rebellion. Too. This is good, isn't it? I was persecutor and injurious. I just like to cause injuries. Let's make a bomb, pressure cushion. But look, don't just blow up the people there. Let's just put some nails in it and some barbells and just when it blow, just blow people. If it doesn't kill them, just injure them. That's that. It's called extremist terrorist. That was Saul. But I obtained what? Mercy.
Undeserved.
That's right. God looked at this fool who was fighting against him, had compassion, and took action. Jesus Christ literally came. The Lord Jesus had to stop this man. He came out of heaven. People think that Jesus just spoke in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That goof on the radio yesterday, he was just in Matthew as if the Lord didn't speak from heaven's glory. The Lord came back in Acts 9, saved Paul. Look at the Bible. You got the so-called Old Testament back there, the 39 books of Genesis through Malachi. Then you got that split we call New Testament, Matthew through Revelation. But you got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There is the book of Acts there. And no wonder you got now Paul's epistles, Romans through Philemon. When this dispensation is over, he goes back to dealing with the Hebrew people, Hebrew through Revelation. That's time passed way back here. This, and here's the transition, the bridge, the book of Acts. How did God go from dealing with one nation, Israel, the Jews, to dealing with the Romans, the dreaded Roman Gentiles? Well, the book of Acts is that transition. It's a bridge. All of these epistles written by Paul right there, that's our doctrine for today. And when the Lord comes and takes us home to heaven through the rapture, he's going to go back to dealing with Israel again, the Hebrew people. And that's the end times for Israel. By the way, it's being set up right now. You see all that stuff going on in the Middle East, Iran, Iraq, Syria, Egypt, you name it. It's setting up the stage for the end times. It's going right that way. But before all that can happen, he's going to take us home soon. So even your Bible is laid out how God said he did it. Paul put that together like that. He put the Bible together. It wasn't some council, some religious council. The Apostle Paul did that. He put it just like God wanted it, by the Spirit of God. Okay? Look what he says here. 1 Timothy, verse number 13. He says, "But I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief." He didn't understand fully what he was doing. And so God moved with compassion, intervened, verse 14, "and the grace of our Lord." So he calls him the Lord because he was a righteous judge. He says, the guy doesn't truly get it. He really is thinking he's doing this for me. I got to make it clear you're not. You're hurting me. You're persecuting me. So watch this. "And the grace," verse 14, "of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and love, which is in" who? "Christ Jesus. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus," by the way, that's the one from heaven's glory, right? He's the one who was already crucified. He already suffered. Now he's Christ Jesus. He came down, Acts 9. "That Christ Jesus," people, when they read this, they think he's talking about the baby in the manger. No, no. Jesus grew up. He died, but he's not on that cross. He resurrected. They're not talking about little baby Jesus. He came to Israel, okay? He grew up in Israel like every Jew. He's talking about the one who was grown and came from heaven's glory. Christ Jesus. Now, watch it. "He came in the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." And chief means the front of the line, okay? Native American chief, he was the one who, if you go on a reservation, the chief, he's the one who rules the reservation. He's got the top position. And when it comes to the body of Christ, Paul has that first, well, it's the first one. Look what he says. "Howbeit," by the way, if you want to explain to somebody the dispensation of grace, how to rightly divide, say, what is Paul first in? He wasn't the first Jew to be saved. You got Peter, James, John, 3,000 in Acts, 5,000 in Acts. Like, it's thousands of Jews. Why was Paul first? Let's look at it. Verse number 16. "Howbeit, for this cause, I obtain" what? "Mercy." He put him in that ministry, that mercy. "That in me first." What is Paul first in? He's the first member of the body of Christ. He's the first man that God ever saved by grace through faith plus no works. The first. Nobody before Paul was saved by God's grace through faith plus no works. Their righteousness was the law. Work, faith plus works, faith plus works, faith plus works. Paul gets saved by grace plus nothing. Faith plus nothing. That's right. That's right. "In me first." Look at everybody. Verse 16. "Jesus Christ might show forth" all what? "Long suffering." He's suffering long today. Yeah, that's why. That's how Jesus suffers today. Paul says if we suffer with him. You say, how is the Lord Jesus who's in heaven, how is he suffering? Nobody's beating on him. Those Romans can't hit him anymore. They can't pull his thing. They can't beat him with a stick. They can't crucify him. So how is the Lord suffering? That's right. Rejection of his word, his truth, his people. That's how he's suffering. Look what he says. "He might show forth all long suffering for a pattern." What's a pattern? When you make something, you use the pattern. If you were trying to make 10 dresses and you only use the pattern for the first one and then that next dress, you made it. That 10th dress would be real big because you start with the pattern, then the pattern makes something, but then you're going to incrementally get bigger. But if you use a pattern, use everyone the same size, pattern. And Paul is the pattern on salvation today. Notice what he said. "For a pattern to them who should hereafter," what's hereafter? From this moment forward, right? "Believe on him," on Jesus Christ our Lord, to what? To life everlasting. See, Paul received everlasting life as a free gift on the road to Damascus, and so do we when we trust him. Not on the road to Damascus. Unless you, if you're actually going on the road to Damascus, that's going to be pretty hairy over there. You go over there, ISIS is going to get you. Okay? They hate all Westerners. Don't go to Damascus or Syria. Okay? All right? Now, you can get saved right here in California or wherever you listen. So the point is, that's what's going on. Paul is the first one. He's the pattern. And that mercy is associated with the ministry of grace. So when he talks to ministers especially, he's saying, listen, that's what's committed to you. You need the mercy of God, but remember to always give that out to the listener. All right, go back to 2 Timothy 1. 2 Timothy 1. Oh, man, I thought I'd get to about 10 or 12 verses today. That ain't going to happen. I ain't even got notes today. I'm just going right up. Man, all right, let's do it. No rush, because we need to get everything. Verse 2, to Timothy, that's the one who honors God, my dearly beloved son, like a son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace. See, God is gracious to us. He's merciful, but we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. God doesn't ever want a believer who trusted Christ to say, God, are you with me? We don't have to pray like David, who was under the law. Take not thy Holy Spirit, your presence away. No believer. We're the children of God today in Christ, right? We never have to say, God, are you with me? He is. But he has a special way that he communicates, and that's through the letters of the Apostle Paul. That's why you got to study out Paul's epistle. That's why the preacher's job, my job and every preacher's job, is to go verse in when you in these pulpits to go verse by verse through Paul's epistles to teach you. And if they're not, that goof was in Matthew. What is he doing over there? He doesn't know how to rightly divide. I could teach Matthew, but I'll keep it over there. I'm teaching Mark on the internet, my 10-minute studies each. One of them is the book of Mark. But I'm not telling people Mark, the doctrine in Mark is for them today.
You need to call him up and correct him.
He ain't going to listen to me.
Why not?
Because that guy, bet he's famous, he's making money, and he's big wig.
He had a question.
You contact him and tell him that I'm going to, I don't waste my time with these fools no more. Yeah, let Matt, you know what? That's what, but brothers like you, that's right. We get them. That's right. I'll look on there, KFIA. I remember the time, and they post who's on there, and I'll get you the information. You're a perfect person to talk to. That's your thing. Good.
Good job.
And let us know what happens. I tried that back in the past with these guys, man. I got too many saints who want help. I ain't got time. Okay, but thank you, Matthew. Look at this. Grace and peace from God the Father in Christ Jesus our Lord. You can see how he's focusing on that ministry that came down from heaven's glory, the resurrected, glorified Lord Jesus Christ. All right, let's keep going. Verse 3. I thank God, whom I serve from my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers night and day. Now, a couple of things there. You notice how he says, I've served God from my forefathers, those religious Jews that he was a part of, with pure conscience. That's why I'm saying when he was killing Jewish believers in Jesus, he really thought he was doing it for God. He really thought he was. Innocent. He was innocent. The Lord says that there are going to be times, he tells his apostles and his disciples, in that tribulation period, he says, they're going to kill you thinking they're doing it for God. That's right. He did. That's why, okay, go back to Acts 9. I got to show you this. Look, this is why the Lord responded the way he did. Look at Acts 9. Look at Acts 9. The Lord was working on this man's heart. It's crazy. You know, people will visit our assembly. Like, somebody will just visit. It'll be a woman from Georgia. I'm just in town. I've been watching your YouTube. I'm in town for business. And they'll come, and then we don't see them again, right? Obviously, because they went back home. Well, it was a woman and her husband from upstate New York on the other side of the country. They visited. And we were talking about the rich young ruler. And during a Q&A, you know, everybody's discussing, she goes, yeah, do you think that maybe the rich young ruler, and I'll explain what happened, the account, do you think that could have been Saul of Tarsus? And I go, he was called a young man named Saul. He was a rich man. He was a ruler in Israel. He was a Pharisee. He had questions for Jesus early in Jesus' ministry. He says, good master, what good thing must I do to inherit eternal life? The Lord says, keep the commandments. Now, don't tell nobody keep the commandments today. That won't save them. But back under the law, it did. But he says, I've done all that from my youth up. What lack I now? And he says, sell all that you have. Sell everything that you have. Give to the poor and come and follow me. And it said he went away sad because he had great riches. Or the riches had him. And I wonder, that could have fit Saul.
I don't think so.
We'll talk about it during the thing. I tell you, and here's why I say that. Let me at least make my case. And then at the Q&A, I would like, we'll start with you. Here's why I say that. He was rich. He was young. He was a ruler. he had some testimony enough about Jesus to kind of get, he was almost there. He was on the fence, but he wasn't ready for the next part of that journey, that truth. Sell all that you're, sell everything you have and come and follow me. He wasn't ready. Now watch what he says here. Here's why I say that. Let's look at it. And I'll have Dodie answer this one for me in the Q&A, because what's the pricks that Paul is fighting? Let's look at it. Look at verse number 3, Acts 9, verse 3. And as he journeyed, speaking of Saul, he's in his terroristic mood and he's gone. Here we go. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus. This is Damascus, Syria. Place right here on earth in the Middle East. And suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. You remember our last couple of studies? We saw that it wasn't just a light. Acts 22 and 26 says it was a great light. It was brighter than the noonday sun. See, this is the Lord's glory coming down, brighter than the sun. Sun pales in comparison to the Lord. Because Paul says he lives in a light. He dwells in a light that no man can enter into because it's too bright. Paul was blinded from this for 3 days. And he had eye problems the rest of his life. He told the Galatians, in the book of Acts, he's looking at the high priest, but he can't really make it out. He was affected by the glory of the Lord Jesus, even physically, for the rest of his life. He tells the Galatians, you guys would have given me your own eyes. They cared that much about him in the beginning. We wish we can get, now you can just get eye transplants and stuff, right? Or at least LASIK surgery, like I got. Look what he said. As he journeyed, verse 3, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined around him, about him, a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Why are you persecuting? When you persecute the Lord's people, you persecute him. And he said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus. The other passage says, Jesus of Nazareth. Whom thou, by the way, Jesus of Nazareth. That's another one, though. Why did he say Jesus of Nazareth? That tells you he had to know him as Jesus of Nazareth. 2 Corinthians 5 says, though we have known Christ after the flesh, Paul knew him after the flesh. But keep going. Here's the point I want to make right here. I am Jesus whom thou persecuted. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. The Bible says they were pricked in their heart. The word prick has to do with a conviction. He had some truth. He was being convicted in his heart. And he had to come to the point where, am I going to give in to the conviction or I'm going to stay in unbelief? Because look at his answer, verse 6. And he, trembling and astonished, says, Lord, he gave in. What wilt thou have me to do? And the rest is history. So we'll talk about that. I need to know what these pricks are, because he had some run-ins, I believe, with Jesus. And that, nobody knows for sure, but that, to me, that wouldn't be that crazy that maybe that was the rich young, it called him the young man named Saul. He was rich. He was a ruler. And that from that, he had this struggle in his heart. But we'll talk about that in Q&A. Go back to 2 Timothy 1. Go back to 2 Timothy. When Paul got saved, he had a pure conscience. A pure conscience doesn't mean you don't have doubts. By the way, God doesn't care. Let me say it like this. God doesn't mind if you have. Let me say it like this. He doesn't mind if you have questions. As long as you sincerely want those questions answered from his word. Now, he doesn't want you in unbelief. And very few people have the heart of like a child of faith. Some people do. But most people are kind of somewhere in the middle. God doesn't mind you kind of questioning. Doubting Thomas. Everybody, you've heard of Doubting Thomas, right? He was an apostle, Thomas. And the reason he's called Doubting Thomas, because you wasn't going to get over on this guy. You had to prove everything. Yes. He didn't. His own other apostles said, we've seen the Lord. He rose from the dead. Thomas says, I ain't believing until I see him. And not just see him. I want to feel him. I'm going to put my hands in the nail holes. Didn't he get pierced in the side? Yep, I want to put my hand up in there too. Then I'll believe. The Lord just over here said, here, Thomas, do it. And Thomas says, sorry, Lord. You, my Lord and my God. John 20. Now John 19. It humbled him. But listen, God don't mind if you have some sincere questions. Saul had them, people do. But he wants you to get to the point when he proves it without a reasonable doubt, don't stay in unbelief. That's what happened here with Saul. He believed God. All right, go back to 2 Timothy. All right, we got 10 minutes. 2 Timothy 1, look at verse number 3. I thank God whom I served from my forefathers. That's what I said about that pure conscience. That without ceasing, I have remembrance of thee in my prayers night and day. Let me just say something about night and day. We don't talk like that. When I say to Krista, see, she is a state, she's when we were courting and she was in Minnesota, I lived in Chicago. I'd say, you know, honey, I never talked. I said, you know, honey, I've been thinking about you night and day. I'd say I've been thinking about you all day and all night. Right. But the way Paul says this, this goes all the way back to Genesis. You remember what it says in the evening and the morning were the what? First day. Right. The evening and the morning. And as a student of the word, I said, well, why does God do that? We say in the morning and evening, like we go morning to evening, but not. He starts it off evening to morning, well, for a couple of reasons.
Because they started it.
Well, this is why they started. Like a Jewish day starts at sundown, right? Now, it's part of the calendar. God, they are on a lunar calendar, and the moon comes out in the evening, right? But it's deeper than that. When creation starts, as far as man's viewpoint, when we open the Bible, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. And what was on the face of the deep? Darkness. And so mankind, our first glimpse of our creator is that he has to take darkness and make light. Evening to morning. That's what it is. And until the Lord Jesus Christ, the day star arrived, till that kingdom come, everything else pales in comparison. It's like nighttime. Paul calls it nighttime. Compared to the light of that kingdom on this earth, everything, the last 6,000 years before, about if that's what he's going to do, it's going to be like evening. But it's interesting, evening and morning, evening and morning. And another reason Paul says it like that to Timothy, Timothy was part Jewish. That's how they related time. Because at times when he dealt with Gentiles, he'll say morning, day and night. Here he says evening and morning. So, but I just want you to see, there's the lunar cycle and stuff, but it's also how mankind, when God first puts us on the scene, it was evening and morning, evening and morning. But that's how he talks about Timothy. Look what he says. In my prayers, night and day. Paul prayed for him. Why? Greatly desiring to see thee. Where is Paul when he writes this? He's in the Roman prison under old despicable Nero who killed him. Greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears. With our 5 minutes left, that's our title, because this book is one about suffering. Suffering for the truth, okay? Paul's last will and testament, he's suffering. He says, Tim, you're going to have to suffer for the truth as well. Don't worry, you're going to get glory, but you got to suffer for the truth. The reason we don't have a bigger assembly is one reason. We preach the truth. People don't want the truth. Go to Joel Osteen's church down there in Texas, Houston, Texas. He fills out a stadium, but he lies to people about the word of God. Oh, let me tell you about my daddy. That's all he talks about is his daddy. He won't tell you a verse from the Bible in context.
It's man's wisdom.
It's man's wisdom. I've seen it. Yeah. And that man makes $100 million a year. And he got thousands of people. But he doesn't have the truth. Let me show you about the Apostle Paul with truth. As we come down in, you're in 2 Timothy 1? Go over here. Look at verse 15. So, Dodie, this will make you feel a little better. We got a little more than Paul had at the end. By the way, even the Lord Jesus Christ, he had 100. He was perfect, never sinned, never harmed anybody. He only gave the truth of God pure. He had 120 people. Out of the millions of Jews that he spoke to in 3 years, he only had 120 in Jerusalem. The great Lord Jesus, the perfect man of God himself, only had a little, what he called them in Luke, fear not, what type of flock? Not big flock, little flock. You're not going to have a lot of people when you have the truth.
And at the cross, Jesus Christ had only 70.
Yeah, it was even less. The rest of them scattered. Exactly. This is real. So don't look for a big old thing. If we start growing that big, y'all be listening for what I'm saying. Okay? Y'all hold it account. No. Look what he says. Greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears. Go over to verse number 15. This thou knowest, that some of those which are in Asia. Y'all better be looking at the verse. That's what. This ain't no denomination where you don't need your Bible. Because you don't. You walk in there, what this guy got to say? All right, good. Yeah. This thou knowest, that all they which are in Asia, that's Asia Minor, Turkey area, be turned away from who? Me, Paul. And what he's talking about, every one of those preachers except Timothy, every one of those congregants, those saints, except Timothy and his saints, that's what he's talking about. Timothy was the only Grace assembly left in that whole entire area. California got two Pauline dispensational churches, two, where they actually got a pastor teaching his own. One down here in San Juan Capistrano, way down in Southern California, and Norcalgrace Fellowship in the whole entire state of California, the largest state as far as population. Two. All of Asia Minor right there had one. Talk about truth. People don't want it. All of them left Paul. And that's what defines it. Is your preacher preaching Paul as the apostle of grace today and his teaching? That defines a Pauline Grace Church. All right, that's the beginning. As we come to end, look at what he says, verse 4. Well, before you look at verse 4, go down to verse number 8. Yep, we got 2 minutes. Look at verse 8. Reason I say that, look here. It's not enough just to talk about Jesus. It's not. That guy on that radio was saying, Jesus this, Jesus, 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 Jesus. But let me show you something. Verse number 8. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord. We're going to see that next Sunday. Nor of me, his what? His prisoner. You can talk about Jesus all you want, but if you're not exalting the apostleship of Paul and his doctrine, you're ashamed of the Lord. Listen, you have, they're a package deal. I get a Muslim some credit. They talk about Allah, and they put right under him a man named who? Who's their prophet?
Muhammad,
yeah. They will blow you up just for making a cartoon of him. Come on now. We should have that same zeal about the Apostle Paul. Don't blow nobody up. Don't harm people. But in your heart, you ought to be that zealous for the Apostle Paul. They're saints in the body of Christ. Got saved by Paul's gospel. Don't want to have anything to do with them. Be not ashamed of the testimony of our Lord. No, they go hand in hand. Nor of me, they're his prisoner. You could talk about Allah you want, all you want in Islam, but if you don't exalt Muhammad as his prophet, that's their whole thing. Allah is my God, only one God, Allah, and his only one prophet, Muhammad. Well, I should make people say, there's only one God, the Lord Jesus, and there's only one Apostle Paul for today. Because it is. That should be our mantra, you know. For real. We got to end. Look at verse. Now, the mindful of thy tears. Go back to verse 4. Why was Timothy crying? Here's what he was crying about. In chapter 1 of 1 Timothy, Paul sent Timothy to tell those men there, don't preach any other doctrine. And Timothy did it. And yet all of them taught other doctrines. And Timothy is thinking he let Paul down. He let the Lord down. He's saying, Paul, they all leaving you. They all leaving us. Maybe it was something I did. And he says, no. You didn't do anything wrong. It was their unbelief. Timothy, in his heart of compassion for the Lord and for Paul and for saints, he was so, and as a minister, I feel this way. When people come and people go and you just labor, you labor, and then it's like nobody appreciates you know, in your times with the Lord, just like, what in the world, Lord? You look at the, I mean, I'm giving you what, yep, you're doing it. But the Lord Jesus himself, we got to end. But in Isaiah, the Messiah says, I spent my energy in vain, my strength in vain. And then he thought, he says, no. I'm doing what the Lord wants, so that's all that counts. That was Jesus' mindset. He looked around Israel. He goes, where are the people? Where are the people? Lord, am I doing it? Yep, son, I'm pleased with you. Okay, then I'll just leave it up to you, Lord. That's their problem. That's how Paul and Timothy, he was crying because he thought that it was something he was doing wrong, that all the people were leaving the truth. It's not. Mm-hmm. He was doing it right. That's why people were leaving. Because God, he used his truth to kind of just, God uses his truth to kind of separate the wheat from the chaff. Mm-hmm. That's what truth is for. All right. Well, we want people to get saved. And we appreciate you saints for attending the ministry of truth in our area. This is the rightly divided word. That's why we look at it. Y'all hold me accountable. I hold you accountable for the word, through the word. I want you to see, because I don't want you to say, he just making that up. That's what the verse, no. I want you to see it. Study it out yourself. That's why we had a Q&A. We've stayed here as long, not today, we won't know on my birthday, but we stayed as long as 7 p.m., okay? I'm going to go let my wife and daughter take care of me, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? One day that I get to just, okay, y'all, would you get that from me? Yeah, I love you, you know. No, they do it all the time. But if you want to get saved, it's through the blood of Christ, right? Faith in Christ. It's the gospel of grace. And God will save you. What we saw, everlasting life. It's eternal security. And if you're saved today, we don't have much time. We're in this last book. This might be the last book that I teach on before the Lord comes. It's the book. If you want to honor God, it'll be one to listen to. The ministry of grace. Everything, your time, talent, treasure, go into the grace message. And it's fruit abound to your account. Okay. One last thing. I want to thank Jim and Denise. We have some saints over in Africa who are looking for some grace materials. And Dodie, too. She helped out on Wednesday. We're going to get some Bibles and send them some Right Division and gospel tracts to Africa. This one man who's been watching our ministry online, he's teaching other pastors the grace message. He watches ours and then in their language, and they need King James Bibles. So we're going to send them some. And we're going to send them some tracts. And we're going to send them Right Division and gospel, you know, salvation message, correct? So we want to thank you three particularly. And let's be in prayer for them, because the Bible is precious over in other countries. Because they can't just go down to Walmart and get it. Some of them got to smuggle them in. We take it for granted, but in America. But thank you all for doing that. That's going to change. People are going to get saved and learn the grace of God over there in that continent, okay? Amen. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you that we can come together with those of like precious faith. It may be a little flock like the Lord had, but we're thankful. I mean, it's not everybody like what happened to the apostle at the end of his life, except Timothy and his assembly. I guess if you have one assembly that's faithful, that might just be what it's going to be in the last day. So I pray that myself and my family and these saints are faithful like Timothy and his. Let us be like Timothy and his assembly. And not like all they which be in Asia who turned away from Paul. I thank you for these faithful saints and their hearts desiring the faith. We pray that these things take root in our heart and we believe them by faith. And let your word, your son, your spirit work through us, Father. We ask that you bless our time in the rest of this day. Bless our time during the Q&A as well. We give you thanks and praise in the name of your son, the precious Savior, the Lord Jesus. Amen.